Thank you very much, Chris, Amy, for that wonderful honor. I'm really very humbled by this, and I want to express my appreciation to the International AIDS Society and to all of you for being so kind to me over all of these many years that I've been involved in this common struggle. Chris is giving me 10 minutes to make remarks on anything I want to talk about this morning. So given that this is an HIV vaccine session, I'm going to spend my 10 minutes taking a little bit of an unusual approach, and that is talking to you about some of the challenges that we have in the unusual situation of trying to develop an HIV vaccine. So I've entitled my talk, An HIV Vaccine, Mapping Uncharted Territory. And the reason I did that is that some of you may know that this month's issue of the Journal of the American Medical Association is devoted entirely to HIV vaccine. And I wrote a commentary for that. And what is in that commentary I'm going to talk to you about over the next 9 minutes or so. And the reason I chose this is because we have a very unusual situation with HIV vaccine. And I hope over the next couple of minutes you'll understand what I mean, because I want to take somewhat of a historical perspective about vaccines in general, having, as the director of NIAID over the last 32 years, been involved in the development of several successful vaccines for a variety of different diseases, not by me, but by scientists who we had been involved with. And it is very interesting that a common theme, a common denominator, pervades all of vaccine research and development. And that has been the empirical approach to vaccine development. And by that I mean that it has been really a rather simple process where vaccinologists mimic natural infection. And why do they mimic natural infection? They do because natural infection recapitulates natural immunity. And if you look historically at a variety of infections for which we have successfully developed vaccines, we can learn something. There are diseases with a considerable degree of morbidity and mortality like polio, measles, mumps, smallpox, and on and on. And in every one of those diseases, the body has told us, despite morbidity and mortality, ultimately, at the end of the day, the body mounts an immune response which clears the virus and leaves you with lifelong immunity against the same pathogen. And so in the history of vaccine development, vaccinologists have looked to mimicking natural infection. And it started off centuries ago with the development of the first vaccine for smallpox, in which an empiric approach was taken. Vaccinate someone with cowpox, which is similar to smallpox, and challenge the individual, and you get protection. The field wasn't nearly as highly sophisticated as it is today, and as you're going to hear in this session. For example, some of you may not realize that the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 1954 was awarded to three scientists from Boston, John Enders, Tom Weller, and Fred Robbins, for what today seems the really simple accomplishment of growing a virus in vitro. So today, can you imagine getting a Nobel Prize just for growing a virus that everybody knew was there? Not discovering the virus, but just growing it. Once the virus was grown, some really simple things happened. Jonas Salk killed the virus. Albert Sabin attenuated the virus. And that transformed the entire global health field of polio. There were no Nature, no Science, no Cell papers. None of them cloned anything. They didn't know what a monoclonal antibody was, and they certainly didn't know anything about B-cell lineage. But we had successful vaccines. The next thing was a whole series of vaccines by another one of my heroes who I got to know during his extraordinary career, Maurice Hilleman, who developed 8 of the 14 vaccines that we get routinely vaccinated for, such as measles, mumps, hepatitis, chickenpox, meningitis, etc., etc. Again, I knew Maurice very, very well. Maurice had no knowledge at the time, not through any fault of his own, about all the intricacies of cloning, of all the things that we do by probing B-cell repertoires, yet we were successful. That was what we call the empiric approach, which is that what we've done up until now is to test a candidate until you get protection, and then identify the correlates of that protection and optimize the regimen. Well, that's what we did more than 30 years ago. We empirically started testing vaccines. And as you can see, among many of these, aiming at B cells started in 1987. I don't want to go through these trials, which many of you in the audience are familiar with. They had the common denominator that they all failed. So we couldn't get a correlate because we had nothing to correlate it with because we didn't get any protection. Until RV144, when we had the first signal of protection, 31%. So as far as the empiric approach goes, that was the first step to say now, okay, we have a signal of efficacy. Let's see if we can improve upon it. And you improve upon it by identifying immune correlates. And in the case of RE144, it was an IgG antibodies against V1, V2, to our surprise. No neutralizing antibodies, no cytotoxic T cells. There was some ADCC. So what we did and what we're doing today is trying to increase the strength, the breadth, and the durability by a number of approaches, multiple boosts, modified vectors, adjuvants. You're going to hear about that as soon as I'm finishing some of the presentations. In fact, right here in South Africa will be the launching in November of HVTN-702, which is really a modified RV144 prime boost regimen with a clade C-HIV. So we're doing what the empiric approach is going to be. Now, however, there's another approach which the field has decided to pursue. And that's when things get exciting but very problematic. That is the theoretic or deductive approach. In other words, determine a priori what the optimum correlate of protection would be and design an immunogen to induce that immune correlate. However, that relies on an assumption. And the assumption is that broadly neutralizing antibodies induced by a vaccine will afford protection against the acquisition of HIV. And so what we did is we, being the field, identified a whole bunch of broadly neutralizing antibodies based on the unusual person, about 20%, who ultimately develops broadly neutralizing antibodies. We cloned them, subcloned them, and identified the epitopes to which they bound. But the question is, do these neutralizing antibodies actually protect against infection? And that's when was launched, again, here, right in South Africa, we've seen that, what's called the AMP trial, to passively transfer broadly neutralizing antibodies to see if they protect. So let's assume, which I think is going to happen, that they do protect. Maybe not one, but perhaps a combination of a few. Then we're left with the challenge. How do we get these neutralizing epitopes in the form of an immunogen that can induce broadly neutralizing antibodies? That is a very difficult task. Why? Because nature itself has consistently failed to do that. And so if we go back and take the approach where all of the other successful vaccines have worked, that is going to be very difficult. Now, the difficulty of this did not escape an iconic vaccinologist who over the years became a very good friend of mine. And that is Albert Sabin. Now, this is a picture of Albert and I 30 years ago. And Albert and I had conversation. I had become friends with him. I was his private physician when he was sick. I gave the eulogy at his funeral at the Arlington National Cemetery after he died. So I knew Albert Sabin very well. And Albert told me, and this is a quote, "Tony, based on what I'm seeing, I don't think we will ever have an HIV vaccine." And he really shocked me because I really care for this man and I completely disagree with him. So what have we done since Albert told me he didn't think we were going to get an HIV vaccine. Or put another way, what are we doing that Jenna, Salk, Sabin, Hillman et al. Never had to do to develop a successful vaccine? We have X-ray crystallography, cryo-EM. We have novel cellular cloning technologies to isolate the rare B cells that recognize the envelope. We have high-throughput deep sequencing in B-cell genes. We have unprecedented interrogation of B-cell lineage to identify unmutated germline B-cells. Salk and Sabin had no idea what an unmutated germline B-cell was. We've done sequential immunogen steering of B-cell lineage to induce broadly neutralizing antibodies. And out of this has come dozens and dozens, and I mean that in a sincere, positive way, Nature, Cell, science papers, over and over. So, what does this tell us? It tells us, I think, something important. If our efforts in developing an HIV vaccine based on the induction of broadly neutralizing antibodies are in fact successful, this feat will represent the most elegant and complex scientific approach towards any vaccine in all of history of vaccinology. Or, if we are unsuccessful, this experience will be recorded as the most highly sophisticated and scientifically elegant proof that the development of such a vaccine is in fact not possible. Now, obviously, I am in the former and not the latter court. So how do I end up with a message to you? My predictions. The development of an HIV vaccine will require both the empiric and theoretical approach. It's not going to be a 98% effective vaccine like measles, but it is going to be pretty good. Broadly neutralizing antibodies are going to play an important, but certainly not the exclusive role. The pathway to an HIV vaccine is going to be full of surprises, so we better be ready for it. And finally, as much as I loved him, my dear friend Albert Sabin will be proven to be incorrect concerning the development of an HIV vaccine. One of the very, very few times that Albert ever was wrong. Thank you.